explain the background that brought me to European alchemy. I outlined the tradition of spiritual alchemy and the revival of alchemy at the end of the 19th century. And I conclude with the influence of alchemy on the reception of yoga in Habsburgian occultism. So the man who brought me to alchemy basically was Karl Kellner, electrochemist from Austria who lived in Vienna and in Hallein, close to Salzburg. He was an industrialist, a successful inventor, member of the Theosophical Society, and high degree Freemason. Kellner had two yoga teachers. His first teacher was Bhima Sena Pratapa, a Punjabi yogi student of the University of Lahore and member of England's Royal Asiatic Society. He wanted to increase the public awareness about yoga in Europe through public demonstrations of the yogic sleep. The second teacher, the Tiger Mahatma, Sri Agamya Guru Paramahansa, a Kashmiri Brahmin, he studied law and worked as a barrister before he traveled around the world teaching yoga. His career ended in England, where he was put into jail for indecently assaulting two women. He was the yoga teacher of illustrious persons like the wife of Daisei Suzuki and Alistair Crowley for a short time in England. So, Kellner published an important essay on yoga that was distributed at the third Congress for Psychology, International Congress for Psychology in Munich, where Pratapa was demonstrating his yoga sleep, and Kellner's brochure was distributed as explanation. So, the basic thoughts of Kellner's essay, yoga is the practical side of each religious system. It comprises exercises and a certain lifestyle that aim at dissolving the illusionary ego consciousness and reaching a union with the general world consciousness, Atma. That was a definition of yoga in line with theosophical definitions of yoga, which he knew from Franz Hartmann. And the yoga sources he used, basically, he used Mitra's translation of the Yoga Sutras and theosophical editions of Hatha Yoga literature. Hatha Yoga, he says, is systematized regulation of breath. It is clear that Hatha Yoga, he says, practices possess the most formidable hypnogenic means, and therefore they are able to create the yogic state in the simplest possible way and faster than any other yoga techniques. So that was the first thing that astonished me, because this essay was published in 1896, and very early for such a positive evaluation of Hatha Yoga. Kellner had also a relation to alchemy. He possessed Rosicrucian manuscripts given to him as a young man by his grandfather, and this ignited his interest in alchemy and chemistry. And he experimented with alchemy in his laboratory, trying to find the elixir of life. As an industrialist, this also had commercial backgrounds, because if he would have found an elixir of life in his laboratory, he would have been not only a millionaire, but a multi-millionaire. There also existed a connection between yoga and alchemy in Kellner's practice. Franz Hartmann, his business partner and fellow theosophist, affirms that the results of Kellner's yoga practice under the guidance of Sri Agamya motivated him to intensify his alchemical work. This is a quotation from Hartmann. published soon after the early death of Kellner. Kellner continued his alchemical experiments with renewed vigor, and it appears from his correspondence that his experiments in making the elixir of life during the first stages of the process were successful, as the material employed went through the changes described in the old books of alchemy. So yoga practice made his alchemical experiments more successful. So I have two questions. Why is a chemist at the end of the 19th century engaged in alchemy? I was astonished to see this. And second, what is the reason for the evaluation of Hatha Yoga as the best and fastest form of yoga? And both led me to the study of the historiography of alchemy in Europe. There are several approaches to European alchemy in academia. First approach, before the 20th century, the most popular approach, alchemy as a pseudoscience, a history of errors. Then, second famous approach, alchemy as catalyst and symbolic representation of psychological and spiritual processes. This approach was developed by Carl Jung and Virgilio Eliade. From the 1990s onwards, the new historiography of alchemy pointed out that alchemy is an integral part of the history of science, especially participated and contributed to the scientific revolution of the early modern era. So, alchemy as symbolism pointing at spiritual processes was not completely outdated after the new historiography of alchemy emerged. During the recent decades, spiritual alchemy that is connected mostly with Jakob Böhme and his students, as a historical strand in its own right, was underlined by historians of alchemy, a strand of alchemy that emerges around 1600. Spiritual alchemy is of special importance for my topic, and so I go a little more into it. Alchemia spiritualis or alchemia mystica, as it was called, there are in the sources several names for it, is a form of Protestant theology based on the so-called lapis Christ analogy, the analogy between Jesus Christ and the philosopher's stone. This kind of theology says that the union with Christ, the divine word, transforms the physical body towards restoring the pre-lapsarian body of Eden, Adam and Eve. So, this subtle body that is restored by the lapis Christ that transforms the body is conceived of as a deified crystalline gem-like body hidden in terrestrial human matter. The bodily transformation through devotional and contemplative practices is described in terms of alchemical techniques. So this is these are the basic concepts of spiritual alchemy. Due to the decline of laboratory alchemical concepts, 19th century occultists often understood alchemy along the lines of spiritual alchemy. The two most famous books in this line are Mary Ann Atwood's Suggestive Inquiry into the Hermetic Mystery from 1850, and the famous Ethan Allen Hitchcock Remarks upon Alchemy and the Alchemists from 1957. Spiritual alchemy played a crucial role in the practice and beliefs of Hermetic societies, such as the now famous Hermetic Order of the Golden Dawn and its various international offshoots. It also permeated the teachings of the Theosophical Society. In short, says Mark Morrison, the West witnessed an alchemical renaissance in the 18th 1780s that gained momentum by the turn of the century. This is a quotation from Morrison's excellent book, Modern Alchemy, Occultism and the Emergence of Atomic Theory. At the end of the 19th century, not only spiritual alchemy was had immense influence in new religious movements, increased efforts have been undertaken to re-establish the full alchemical circle, as I call it, that connects the inner transformation of the alchemist with the transmutation of substances in the laboratory. So, here a quotation from Joris Karl Huysmans, down there, a study on French Satanism, but with many informations about the whole occult scene. Des Hermies, who is well acquainted with the underworld of science, maintains that more than 40 alchemic furnaces are now alight in France, and that in Hanover and Bavaria, the adepts are more numerous yet. The revival of laboratory alchemy around 1900 had a scientific background. Scientifically literate occultists justified the recent practical experiments, referring to the cutting-edge chemistry and physics that challenged the dogma of the irreducibility of the chemical elements. Alchemy thus was presented as an ancient wisdom that anticipated the insights of most modern chemistry. Book in the, that is representative for this development is Will Westwood, The Science of Alchemy, Spiritual and Material, from 1893. So, Karl Kellner, to come back to this person, very good, fits very well in this picture. He wrote a manuscript that he handed out to the Austrian Academy of Science in 1896 on the experimental proof of the convertibility of the so-called elements. That is this kind of chemistry that they wanted to connect with alchemy. Here you have a page of this manuscript where he is explaining an apparatus with high voltage electricity and magnetism to convert elements into each other. So he was not only in contact with this new experimental alchemy, but also with the spiritual alchemy tradition. And the contact was made by Alois Mailänder. Mailänder was a weaver by profession, working in a factory in Kempten, southern Germany. He was influenced by Jakob Böhme. His teacher was an itinerant carpenter and was a Rosicrucian alchemist named Preston. So this is really, how to say, grassroots Rosicrucianism. Yeah? And he was, Mailänder was a kind of Ramakrishna for the occult upper crust of the Habsburg Empire. He was founder of the Bund der Verheißung, Association of Promise, a French Christian community, a small one. And in 1884, the Theosophist Typisch Leiden, a German Theosophist, discovered him for the occult aristocracy, and for 10 years or so, all famous Theosophists went to see Mailänder and be taught by him. He lived as a spiritual teacher from 1890 onwards in Dreieichenheim, close to Frankfurt. Here we see some of Mailänder's students and himself. Gebhardt, a banker and industrialist, Friedrich Eckstein, the man in the upper row middle, friend of Sigmund Freud, secretary of the famous composer Anton Bruckner, Nikolaus Gabele is the brother of law of Mailänder, Mailänder himself, and Hübsch Leiden is discovered. And here we have a photo taken in Vienna that shows two members of Mailänder's circles. Again, Gebhardt and Eckstein together with Kellner, and so you see that he was in this circle that was connected with Mailänder, and according to Franz Hartmann, he was also a student of Mailänder. Interestingly, Mailänder taught the so-called kerning exercises, a system of body-centered exercises based on the ideas from the tradition of spiritual alchemy. Among occultists, this system was considered to be of Rosicrucian origin. The kerning exercises have been developed during the first half of the 19th century by Johann Baptist Krebs, a German opera singer, vocal coach, and famous Freemason, also known under his pen name Kerning. Therefore we speak of kerning exercises. The kerning exercises comprised breathing techniques, concentration on different parts of the body, especially certain mystical centers, murmuring or silent repetition of short sentences or words, the imaginative spelling of these letters and words within the centers of the body, and by virtue of these practices, the divine inner word should permeate and transform the human body. So these are the kerning exercises. Spiritual alchemy in the tradition of kerning Mailänder caused a revision of the role of the human body within Habsburgian occultism. I quote Karl Weinfurter from Prague, "Master Kerning ceaselessly points to the fact that God is present within the whole body. 99% of the occultists and theosophists believe that human mystical development starts within the soul. This view is one of the greatest mistakes of modern occult literature. Exactly the opposite is true. Mystical blossoming first happens within the body." And Gustav Meyrink, another student of Mailänder, says, "If the only thing I had learned from this man, Mailänder, was that the body must be included in the transformation of the person through yoga, he would have earned my lifelong gratitude for that insight alone." So, my concluding remarks. Spiritual alchemy in the form of the kerning exercises heavily influenced the reception of yoga within Mailänder's circle and triggered the appreciation of Hatha yoga. All of Mailänder's Indophile theosophical students considered these exercises to be a kind of European yoga based on Rosicrucian traditions. In his essay on yoga, Karl Kellner writes, "Among the Christian mystics, Jakob Böhme and his discourse between the master and his disciple," he refers to De Vita Mentalis from 1622, "and J. Krebs, Kerning, represent the best that has ever written in German about yoga practices. Yoga was considered to be the best method for the spiritual purification and union with the divine that is necessary for successful laboratory alchemy." So that is the relation to experimental alchemy. That was it. By yoga.
I mean,
yeah, it's very probably so, but hard to prove, because with Kerning we are in the first half of the 19th century. So what could have influenced these exercises? I think the translation of the Upanishads by Onkitirti Parom, because there were some yoga Upanishads in this translation included, or other sources. The only one who comes closer to the kerning exercises probably is a German philosopher called Carl Christian Krause, who is famous in Spain and in Latin America with his so-called Krausismo. The philosopher Krause is a romantic philosopher who lived door to door with Arthur Schopenhauer, and Krauss did together with Schopenhauer the Sanskrit library in Dresden and translated Sanskrit texts. And it is said by Ernst Benz years ago, he brought up this thesis that Krause practiced a kind of meditation with the syllable Om and other sounds, and had this from Indian sources. This is the, so this is the next possible source that I know, but probably other new research will bring up new sources.
In Dresden?
In Dresden. There was a kind of store, a Schrank. What is a Schrank?
Cupboard.
A cupboard, yeah. It is said that he visited the Sanskrit cupboard of the Dresden library together with Schopenhauer. I never seen a cupboard. But I haven't been in the Dresden library. I don't know if there is any stuff. Or is the, or if this is only a rumor.
This is some really tantalizing connections that you made. It's really fascinating. Just as a question, when you mentioned these, the kind of practices, you talk about kind of use of, you know, memory words, you talk about essentially visualization or embedding the symbols within the body.
Yes.
Is there, you know, were there actual physical movements as well, or physical shapes? Or?
Not that I know. From the descriptions of Weinfurter, they practiced in a sitting position on chairs, and they started with the feet, and then went to the knees, and then the pelvis upwards, concentrating on these special centers and visualizing the sounds in the centers. And Mailänder's speciality was that he wanted to see concrete results. He wanted to see the letters on the skin.
What actually appear?
Actually appearing. And he let people practice for hours and days until they became half crazy. And he wanted to see concrete results because it's a transformation of the physical body that is saying.
Hi, I was wondering that you mentioned the spiritual alchemy tradition, but Kellner, whom you started with, you said he was a chemist and was also doing this alchemy about actually transforming elements.
Yes.
And within the theosophical circles, there are some people like Legmeter, particularly, who is doing occult chemistry.
Yes.
And there's a whole occult chemistry tradition, which is about elements and spirituality of elements rather than bodies.
Yes.
Is that tradition coming into this at all?
This is much younger. The Leadbeater Besant stuff is a kind of modern revision of alchemy, one can say, based on visionary looking into the atomic structures and so on. Yeah. But this is not the transforming work that in the Rosicrucian tradition is practiced, as I would say. I don't know any outside of this Habsburgian circle and the Mailänder people. I don't know any theosophist who actually practiced spiritual alchemy or laboratory practice. Probably there were, but I don't know.
Yeah, I only have
just
one question.
Yes.
Just very short remark. I have a very vague memory on a publication which is called the Glückselige Insel, and this is a site in Berlin, and it's related to the adaption of Buddhism in Berlin.
But yes, from Volker Zotz.
Volker?
Zotz.
Zotz, yeah, I couldn't remember the name. So I was wondering if so, if there is also some relation from that side to what you have to say.
No, good idea.
So did you say that the cranial exercises came from singing exercises? or he was an opera singer? Is that
yes, right? Yes.
Is there any continuity of practice within kind of a singing tradition with the
characters? I'm just starting to study the literature that Kellner wrote in detail. He's surely influenced by Pestalozzi, a reform pedagogist, and many experiences of this of his singing teaching and singing coaching is of course influential in his practices. He's a little bit like other reformers of body culture in the 19th century with an occult background. He was not the only one. Mm.
And do you know if he taught these exercises to a singing student, or was it just the occultists?
No, I think this was just the Freemasonry circles and people interested in those equations.
Any further question? Thank you very much.